I'm Gary Stormo, and I'm going to be talking about motifs for transcription factor binding sites, or it could be RNA binding proteins, but basically modeling protein DNA or protein RNA interactions. I've met a few of you, but for most of you, I don't really know what your background is. I know a little bit about what you've covered in the course so far, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to start it with really basic stuff that I think probably you all know, but I'm going to go over it quickly. If at some point I jump ahead and you don't follow what I'm talking about, let me know, because if you get lost early on, it'll be a problem later. Also, there's another reason for doing this. So operationally, what you're going to see now is actually pretty similar to what you've already seen with position-specific scoring matrices for proteins, but the underlying rationale is quite different. In that case, you were studying evolution. You're looking at probabilities of protein sequences given that it belongs to a certain family and that they're homologous. As I said, we're going to have a similar formalism, but we're not studying evolution in general. I mean, we can look at regulatory sites between species, but for the most part, we're talking about regulatory sites all within a single species. And so the motifs that we're looking at are, in general, not due to evolution. They're functionally constrained. So that motivation is different. Also, I want to specify that, unfortunately, the literature is a bit confused, and people use the same word to mean different things. And so I'll tell you what I mean when I say, for instance, a position weight matrix, which is not always what someone in the literature means by it. So this is the general outline. We're going to talk about position weight matrices. That's the, I guess I would call it the standard model for representing specificity of a DNA binding protein. Talk about general features, you know, how you use it. I'm also going to talk about the limitations and extensions that one can do. We'll talk about how one sets the weights. I'll give you a little bit of history and some general ideas. I'm then going to spend a little bit of time talking about how one nowadays uses high-throughput experimental data and also in vivo location data, such as ChIP-seq data. Okay, so just a bit of terminology to get started. Sites versus motifs. A site has a sequence made of DNA that only contains the letters A, C, G, and T. A motif you can think of as a representation that covers lots of variable sites that all have the same function. If you think about simple restriction enzymes like ECOR1, the site and the motif are the same because it only recognizes one sequence. Whereas for HINK2, it recognizes four different sequences, but I can summarize that in a motif where Y means pyrimidine and R means purine. Now for transcription factors, it's a step more complicated, because we're going to have quantitative binding. In each of those two cases, it's all or none. You either bind and cut or you don't. With transcription factor binding sites, you have strong sites and moderate sites and weak sites and other sites. So we need a more quantitative model. I should say that another way to think about sites is a particular location in the genome. So if I talk about the lac repressor binding site, I can talk about the sequence of it, or I can just say, well, it's a position, whatever it is, you know, 5,963. But I can go back and forth between those two things as long as I have a genome sequence. Okay, I just said transcription factors don't bind to just one sequence. There's generally a consensus sequence. Usually it's the most preferred sequence, or it's the most common sequence if you make an alignment. But it's important to realize, and in fact, you know, when I started out, that's what we had to work with. For most, there weren't very many transcription factors that were known, and people were working hard to try to identify consensus sequences of new factors. But it became clear very early on that a consensus is not actually a very good representation. Because when you have a consensus sequence, like for instance, TATAAT, you could search for that, of course, but since most binding sites for that factor don't have that sequence, you have to allow mismatches. And the problem with consensus sequences, well, I'll get to it in a second, but here's the general weight matrix model. Also called position-specific scoring matrices. I mean, that was originally introduced for proteins, but this is a case where people use the same name to mean two different things. This matrix now represents a binding site for some factor. It binds to a six-long sequence, so there are six columns, and at every position in the binding site, a particular DNA sequence might have any of A, C, G, or T, And so the point is that I can now give it any particular sequence, CTA, TAA, and get a score for that. So we'll come back to what that score means in a minute, but just for this example, I get a score of minus 24 because I have minus 10 for a C in the first position, minus 6 for a T in the second, and so on. I just add up the values that correspond to that sequence. Now I can take that matrix, I mean it really, in some sense, if it's a good matrix, it represents the specificity of the protein, and I can imagine the protein just sliding along the DNA. So I move it over one position, and now I get a much better score. In fact, that's the best possible score because it has the best possible score in every column. So that we would consider the consensus sequence. But this is the point I was trying to make about the advantage of PWMs over consensus sequences. Remember, in consensus sequence, I can look for a sequence and allow, you know, one or two mismatches, but I don't get to weight mismatches differently. Here you'll notice that an A is the preferred base in this position, and furthermore, if I change that A to anything else, the score is going to drop by a lot. This position also has an A preferred, but it doesn't really matter very much. It's not going to change the score if I replace that A with something else. So that's the fundamental advantage. You've probably all seen logos like this. These were invented Tom Schneider. I'll come back in a second to talk a little bit more how those are generated. But I'm sure you've seen those kinds of things. And they're based on the model. So there's nothing in a logo. They're nice visualizations, but the underlying mathematical model is what you should keep in mind. So as I just said, there's a sort of a generalization of the consensus where I get to have position-specific penalties for not matching to the consensus. There's no advantage to consensus sequences. Some people, there are things in the literature that say, oh, PWMs give you way too many false positives. Well, that depends on what threshold you use. If I pick a threshold of 43, there's no false positives, right? I mean, but I can lower the threshold, and I can lower it in such a way that I capture things that are very close. If I want to make a weight matrix that gives me exactly the same answer as a consensus, that's easy to do. I just put a 1 for the consensus sequence, 0 for everything else, and I require, you know, a 6 for the score. Or if I allow one mismatch, and I require 5. So anyway, the point is that there's no advantage to consensus sequences, even though some people say that sometimes. But clearly, if I have a lousy matrix, I'm going to get lousy results. So in just a second, we'll get to where do the numbers come from, how do we find a matrix that's a good representation of the protein we're interested in. Just to make another simple point, you could imagine taking the sequence itself, A, C, G, and T, and encoding it in the same form of a matrix, but I'm just going to have a 1 for which base occurs at which position and a 0 for all the other bases, right? And then I can think of my score as just the dot product of those. I just multiply them together and sum up the elements, right? So in other words, the sequence is just pulling out the elements of the matrix, as I just showed you a second ago, that correspond to that sequence. But the nice way, I think, the good way of the advantage of thinking about it this way is you could think of, you know, the sequence, I've encoded it in some way, ones and zeros, and the W just gives me the weight. How important is a certain feature at a certain position? But I can add more features. As I mentioned at the very beginning, well, one of the things we'll talk about is the limitations of PWMs and how we can add more features if they're useful. I mean, obviously, one of the things that's a fundamental property of position weight matrices is the underlying assumption that the positions are independent. I get a score for having an A here, and it doesn't matter what its neighbors are. Well, that may or may not be the way proteins work. And in fact, there are examples where proteins don't work that way. For some it works that way, and for some it doesn't. There's a quote I like from a famous statistician named George Box. You've probably all heard of box plots, and you probably thought they were named that because they look like a box. But actually, they were named by the inventor, whose name was George Box. Anyway, his quote is, all models are wrong, some models are useful. I would say it a little differently. All models are approximations, and whether it's good enough depends on what you're going to use it for. So PWMs are clearly an approximation. Sometimes they're good enough, sometimes they're not. Depends partly on what protein you're looking at. Some proteins are well approximated by a simple model, some are not. But it may also depend on what you're going to do with it. So there's two important issues. One is this additivity thing I just mentioned. The other one is where the parameters come from. Let me do the second one first. So let's imagine, when I made this slide many years ago, and at the time, this would have been a daunting experiment. I could imagine a protein that binds to a four-long sequence. I could, you know, synthesize all possible four-long sequences. I'm not showing all of them here. There's 256, and measure their binding energy one at a time. All right. So I, you know, nowadays, as I'll show you in a few minutes, that's actually not a hard experiment to do. But in the early days, that was hard. Anyway, the point is that, you know, let's say these are the binding energies of all possible sequences. If additivity holds, then I get this little matrix out right here because I can get the energy of any sequence just by summing up the appropriate values. Okay, so that's the issue. Is this a good approximation to this or not? I also want to point out one other thing. There are two conventions that are used in the field. In the first example I showed you of the position weight matrix, I said this is the best possible site because it had the largest possible score. That's the bioinformatics model, but if you're a physicist, you know that the lowest energy is the best site. So I just said this is an energy matrix, so this would be the best site because it has the lowest energy. And so unfortunately, again, both conventions are used in the literature and both conventions are used in my talk, but it'll usually be clear what I'm talking about one way or the other. But you should just keep that in mind. All you really have to think about is a sign switch. If the good guys have a higher score, then you're talking about bioinformatics. If the good guys have a low score, then you're talking about energy. So let's assume that the, you know, we measure these things and we're just simply asking the question, is a simple model a good one? We test this and it turns out not to be a good one. We say, well, what can we do about it? Well, we can make a more complicated model. I said, you know, this assumes the positions are independent. Well, what if actually the energy you get for having an A in one position depends on what its neighbor is? I can build a model that has all the dinucleotides and fill in the numbers for that. And then I can test, well, how good a fit is that? And, you know, maybe it's still not a good fit, so I have to go to trinucleotide. At some point, I come back to, this is actually a weight matrix right here, but it's also, you call it a vector, you can also just call it a lookup table, right? What we hope usually is that we can get away with something that's relatively simple because then we have relatively small numbers of parameters to estimate. But just keep in mind that, you know, somewhere around here we're going to end up with a perfect representation of the data. Now, what, of course, as I just said, one of the reasons we hope for a simple model is we have fewer parameters to estimate. As I, every time I increase complexity from mono to di to tri, I'm exponentially increasing the number of parameters, multiplying by a factor of 4. Not quite, because I'm reducing the number of columns, but approximately increasing the number of parameters by a factor of 4. So, you know, that could be a problem. There's an alternative way to do it, and there's been some nice papers from Remo Rose lately. I give you a set here where, so think for a second about why additivity might or might not work. It might work if the protein has amino acids and each amino acid looks at a particular base pair and that's all that matters. It gets the energy like that. But maybe an amino acid interacts with two base pairs. There are examples of that. Then if I change one of them, it might change how the protein binds, and so they're not independent. Another thing is that the DNA itself has structure. I mean, we think of DNA as sort of being this rigid rod, but in fact, the sequence, different sequences can have different structures. They can change the major or minor groove widths. They can change intrinsic curvature, some other properties like that. And so that, those depend on nearest neighbors or even longer stretches of sequence. So that if the structure is important to the binding, then you might have to go to higher order parameters to capture that. And what Remo has shown is basically there are certainly cases where that's true, and what you can get away with is a smaller number of parameters. So for instance, instead of having all 16 dinucleotides, you can just use the mononucleotides that capture sort of the energy of having a particular base, plus 3 or 4 structural parameters to capture the, you know, minor groove width or something like that that's important. So it's relatively new work, but there's a fair amount of work recently about how one can extend the simple PWM by introducing additional structural parameters instead of, you know, increasing exponentially the number of sequence parameters. In the end, I mean, what he showed in, and I think it's this paper at the bottom here, what they showed was you get equally good fit to the data by using a trinucleotide model, which has lots and lots of parameters, as you do with a smaller number of parameters that include some structural things. Okay, now we're going to talk about how to set the matrix elements. Historically, there have been quite a few methods. I'm going to talk about just really two. One is if I just have a collection of binding sites. This might come from ChIP-seq data, or in the old days, it just came from genetics. I identified sets of binding sites across a genome, and I want to model them. And so generally, what one's going to do is a probabilistic model. This is similar to what you saw with proteins, but again, the rationale is different. These are not related probabilistically via evolution. They're related probabilistically via their functions, selection for function. The other thing is that if I actually have quantitative binding site, that is, instead of or in addition to having a collection of known sites, I know that, you know, this site is twice as good as that one. I have essentially a ranking, and hopefully more than just a ranking, but actually quantitative data that says what the KDs are, or what the relative affinities are of lots of different sequences. I can just do regression. That is, I can find the parameters of my model that represent the quantitative specificity as well as possible. And I'll show how to do that taking advantage of high throughput data. But let me just work through this, and I'm doing it partly because it's related to things you've already seen, but again, this is a case where the terminology is somewhat confusing. So let's take an example where we just have a collection of binding sites and we've lined them up. This happens to be the minus 10 region of E. coli promoters. And when I made this slide, there were 242 such sites known. So NBI, that's the number of each base at each position in that alignment. I can turn that into a frequency or a probability if you want, just by dividing by the total. Some people call this a position weight matrix, but that's not what I this is what I call a position weight matrix. Here, if I want to say, given a sequence, and I want to know, does it belong to this set? Does it belong to the class of minus 10 regions? Given this data here, I would multiply those probabilities together to get the total probability, right? And the way I describe the weight matrix is it's an additive function. I have a score, and I'm going to add them up. So the way you take a product and turn it into a sum is you just take the logarithm, right? And that's the way it was earliest done, but we did one other thing. We added, well, let's actually divide by what we expect by chance. So this PB here represents the background probability. Okay, so now it does a couple things. For one is, it sort of sets a baseline. If the observed frequency is the same as I expect from the background, then this ratio is 1 and the log is 0. So it sets a sort of a background. And in fact, sometimes I don't know how big the site is, and what I'll see is if I line my sites up here, and as I extend them out, pretty soon the weights will all go to zero because I'm just picking up background sequence. But in addition, now I have positive numbers for things that are preferred and negative numbers for things that are discriminated against. So again, it sort of is a clean separation between the good guys and the bad guys. So we call this a log odds position weight matrix. Let's see. And then you can do one more thing. We term this the information content, and here's one way to write the formula. Sometimes it's written as substituting this equation up here in for W here, and when it's written that way, then it's what a computer scientist would call relative entropy, what a statistician would call Kolbach-Leibler distance. It's a likelihood ratio score. In fact, I'll show you in a second. It's the maximum likelihood estimate of the model. Variety of things. Anyway, we just call it information content, and it will vary. It can be more than 2 bits if your background probability is, if you have a highly conserved base and the background probability is less than 0.5. But in general, for most DNA sequences, it's going to vary between zero for no information that is essentially random to 2 bits for something that's very highly conserved. Again, I'm just showing you this again. This is the classic logo invented by Tom Schneider. The height at any position is the total information content, and then the letters themselves are in proportion to their frequency or probability. Now, there are other kinds of logos. I think the one over there uses one where all the columns are the same height, and all it's showing is the frequency. I think that's used in this poster over here too. So there are alternative ways to show logos. If you see this kind of, and it's obvious what it is, because either all the letters, all the columns are the same height or they're not, this way is just emphasizing information content, so you can see which positions actually really matter. So here's, I was going to give, I don't think this is actually in the notes I gave you, I added it later. I'm just going to go through a quick primer. It's important later, and it's actually pretty easy. So just imagine that you're given two probability distributions. I'll call them P and Q. Just to make it simple, let's think heads and tails, okay? I have two, what I'm told is, I'm going to flip a coin and you have to tell which one it is. I'm going to tell you in advance that one of these coins is fair, 50% heads and tails, and the other one is biased. It comes up heads two-thirds of the time. Okay, so in both cases, the sum of the heads and tails equals one. And I'm going to give you some data. I'm going to flip it a bunch of times, and then you have to tell me which coin it is. So in this case, I've specified everything. And what you can see, I mean, if I just flip it once and it comes up heads, then it's more likely to be the one that's two-thirds heads than the other one. But that's no proof, certainly. But if I flipped it 100 times and it came up 65% heads, then you'd be pretty confident it was the one that is two-thirds heads. So a way to quantify that is what's called a likelihood ratio. So I would just take the product of the ratio of those two probabilities, probability of heads for one model and the other one, raised to the power of the number of heads, and then also the product of the probability of tails divided by the probability of tails in the other model, raised to the power of the number of tails. That's not overly familiar to you. I'm sure you can sit down and figure it out. Anyway, you could take the log of that and you end up with this equation right here. So this says that if I'm given two probability distributions and some data, I can tell which of those two probability distributions is better fit to my data and by how much. I get a quantitative value out of this. Okay, but now suppose that I don't actually give you these distributions. Maybe I give you one, which is sort of a null distribution, random distribution, and I give you some data, but I say, well, find out of all possible distribution, finds the one that fits the data the best. It's pretty easy to prove, I don't include it here, but it's pretty easy to prove that the maximum likelihood distribution is just the one that fits the data. It's exact match of the data. That comes out of this equation right here. Out of all possible, well, this formula, this is relative entropy, is always greater than or equal to zero. It's equal to zero only if P and Q are identical. For any other value where they're not identical, this is always greater than zero. So what that says is out of any two distributions I compare, the one that fits the data is always going to be the best. Okay, as I said, we call it information content. It's called relative entropy, Kolbach-Leibler distance. It's related to chi-square or g-statistic. That's useful because when people do motif finding, oftentimes the criteria they use for did I find the best motif is did I maximize the information content? And this is just proving, well, yes, that's actually the maximum likelihood motif. That's the best motif you could have found for that particular data set. So let's talk about modeling experimental data. So if we just had one binding site, one sequence, here's our sequence, here's our protein, this is the reaction we're modeling, there's a on rate and an off rate, and we can collect and measure the fraction of DNA sequences that are bound. At equilibrium, the on and off rates are equal when I take the concentrations into account. And so the KD is just the off rate divided by the on rate. It can be determined by measuring the free concentration of protein and DNA and the complex. That's 1 over the KA. We usually think of the KA is, when I talk about affinity, I'm usually talking about KA, but when it's plotted, it's easier to think about KD. So if I do this experiment where I increase the protein concentration, at some point, half of the DNA will be bound, and at that protein concentration, that's the KD. A simple way to do that is a gel shift, for instance. I start with DNA labeled in some way, and I add more and more protein, and at some point, I get where half of the DNA is bound and half of it's unbound, and that concentration of protein is the KD. 1 over that is the KA, which is what I mean by affinity. Okay, so that's for a single sequence, but what we really care about is how does the affinity change when I make mutations in the sequence? What happens? If it's a restriction enzyme, it's going to go basically to zero as soon as they make one mutation. But for transcription factors, that's not true. I could imagine doing that experiment I just showed you over and over and over and over again for lots of different sequences. But a more efficient way is to take just a mixture of DNA sequences. So the different colors here represent different sequences. Add my protein, pull out the guys that are bound to it, and send them off to high-throughput sequencing or some other high-throughput method. What you could think of what I'm doing is I'm basically taking a slice through this curve here. The problem is I don't actually know this axis. That's what I'm trying to estimate, is what is the relative affinity of each sequence. And I don't even really know what the protein concentration is, because this is free protein concentration. I know how much protein I added, but a lot of it's going to be bound. But in some sense, it doesn't really matter, because what we care about is not absolute KDs, but relative KDs. So a way to think about it is I'm showing you the slice through the data. All I really have is the y-axis. I have the probability of each sequence, but I can fit that to a model that reconstructs this curve essentially for me. I can find one that gives the best fit. And I'll show you in a little more detail what I mean by that. So I'm going to talk quickly about three different high-throughput methods. All these, well, I guess PBMs are a little more than 10 years old now, but all these methods, well, they've even been around and they've been updated to take advantage of high-throughput sequencing really in the last few years. So in protein-binding microarrays, I'm sure you're familiar with microarrays. You have DNA printed on an array. You know the sequence by where it is on the array. The way these are made is there's a constant region to hybridize a primer and extend it. So in the end, what's on the array is double-stranded DNA. You can then add your protein and a way to visualize it. Either the protein itself is fluorescent or you have a fluorescent antibody. So in the end, you end up with an intensity for each spot on the array. And since each one of these has a different sequence and a known sequence, you can use that to try to infer what the motif is. In fact, the current universal array design contains somewhere on the array, every 10 long sequence occurs once. Another method, which has been around for a long time, but has more recently been made high throughput, is called CellEx. You start with a random pool, typically a synthetic random pool, but it could be you take a genome and chop it up randomly. You have your protein immobilized in some way on a surface or on a bead, or maybe you run a gel like I showed you earlier. Some way to collect the DNA that's bound to the protein. And then you separate unbound and bound. And in the old days, because there's always a fair amount of background, DNA just sticks to the column or however you've done it, you would do this multiple times. You would PCR amplify the bound stuff, rebind it, et cetera, and then do some sequencing. And we would sequence maybe 50 colonies. And we'd get a picture of what the specificity was like, but it was hardly quantitative. Nowadays, using high-throughput sequencing, we can even do just one round of binding, sequence what comes out and sequence what we started with. And the ratio of what comes out and what you started with is actually related directly to the affinity, which I'll show you in a second. Another method, this is not actually in vitro because we use E. coli, but we're using E. coli as a test tube, basically. You put in a transcription factor that you care about. In this particular version, which has been optimized by Scott Wolf, the transcription factor is fused to the omega subunit of E. coli. That's a non-essential subunit of RNA polymerase. So if you delete omega, the cells are okay. They don't really care. But the fact that we fuse it means that now any transcription factor we care about, no matter what its normal function is, it's now an activator because it has an affinity for the polymerase. So you're set up in a case where you have a randomized DNA sequence upstream of a very weak promoter driving expression of an essential gene. That is, you grow the cells in conditions where if they don't make this protein, they don't grow. And so how fast they grow will depend on how good a binding site this is. Again, in the old days, you would do this experiment, you would plate your library out, and after a day or two, you would pick the biggest colonies and sequence 20 or 50 or something. Nowadays, we just scrape the plate. So we get everything. We get the high affinity guys, because those are colonies that have grown a lot, and so they have lots of that sequence, and you have the low affinity guy. You have guys that didn't grow at all because they're still on the plate. But, okay, so I'm going to go through, well, I, I'm going to I'm going to bring up one issue before I get into exactly how we analyze this data. So high throughput in vitro binding analysis can give good quantitative models of intrinsic binding specificity. The nice thing about this, and the reason we like to do this a lot, is, alternatively, you could just look at where the protein binds in the cell, but that's confounded by lots of things. In eukaryotes, it's confounded by where the nucleosomes are. It's also confounded by other proteins that either compete or cooperate with it. By doing it in vitro, where you just have one purified protein, you really are understanding the intrinsic specificity. What's the specificity of this protein in the absence of any confounding factors? Just having more data isn't sufficient, as I'll show just sort of briefly. You also need good analysis methods. The log odds method that I described earlier, if we're just given a collection of sites, is based on some assumptions, and I'll describe what those are and also point out that they're not always true. And so what we've come to use are what we call energetic models. Now we have a nonlinear relationship between binding affinity and binding probability, and I'll show you what I mean by that in a second. So the log odds method is equivalent to an energy method under one simple assumption, and that is that the sites are drawn from a Boltzmann distribution. You can all think back to your thermodynamics days. Here's a description of the Boltzmann distribution where this F of SI, so SI is a particular sequence, and what I mean here, just in the previous notation, this is the frequency that sequence is being bound in my collection of sites. P I'm using again as my prior probability, my background probability for that sequence. And E is the energy of that sequence. According to the Boltzmann distribution, my binding probability will be equal to this relationship. It's easy to think about that. Suppose the protein was nonspecific, that is, it bound every sequence with the same energy, then obviously the posterior and the prior would be the same. It's equally likely to bind anywhere in the genome. On the other hand, if the prior is equally likely for everything, then you're going to be distributed just by the energies. Okay? But in this case, we're going to take both into account simultaneously. And if I just rearrange this equation, I get that the energy is equal to the ratio of the observed frequency divided by the expected frequency. Exactly what I showed you before, except I have a minus sign out here, remember, because I'm talking about energy now instead of bioinformatics scores. So under the assumption that the sites I've been selected for, you know, the sites have been selected via a Boltzmann distribution, then those two things are equivalent. However, it was pointed out, I mean, we sort of knew this all along, but we sort of ignored it. We thought it wasn't that important, and we didn't quite know how to deal with it. And then this paper by Georgievich et al. Came out pointing out that it is actually important. It can make a big difference. But they use an example in E. coli. If you use two different models for representing, taking the same data, the same training data, and you build a motif from it using two different approaches, this method gave you twice as many false positives as this method. So it makes a difference. So the point is that in reality, we have this relationship called the Fermi-Dirac distribution. This is the same energy I talked about before, but now there's a new term which has to do with the protein concentration. And it's obvious if you think about it, if I increase the protein concentration, the probability of everybody binding goes up. Until you get to one, you can't be more than 100% bound, right? So there's a saturation effect. And the question is that relevant or not? Well, in E. coli, the lac repressor, for instance, is bound probably 98-99% of the time, and many other things are too. So it really is the case that some sites in vivo, and there's evidence that the same things happens in eukaryotic cells, although it's less well studied. There's evidence that happens there as well. So what it really means is you should be fitting the data to this kind of a distribution rather than this kind of a distribution. Well, how different are those? Just as a simple example, let's suppose my protein concentration, either in the test tube or in a cell, is such that the consensus sequence, which I define, I'm just going to define that to be the reference energy zero, and so every mutation increases the energy some amount, okay? So my consensus sequence is bound at, let's say, 95%. If I now look at a different sequence, or I look at a mutation in the genome that increases the binding energy by 2 units, and the units I'm using are just KT because it makes the math easier, that would predict that the binding probability should drop from 95% down to 15%, a huge drop in binding probability. On the other hand, if I realize that the cell is actually near saturation, the same mutation in reality might only cause a 15% drop in binding probability. Another way to think about it is, suppose I had a different binding site. This is no longer the consensus site. It's already, you know, 2 kT worse than the consensus. And then I add the same mutation I did here. It looks like it will, in fact, have a very dramatic decrease in binding probability. So what that says is the same mutation, remember this mutation from here to here is the same as that mutation from there to there. It would make me think that those things are not additive, they're not independent. The effect of a particular mutation appears to depend on its context. But that's because I'm thinking about it purely in terms of probability, not in terms of energy. So this is a perfectly additive energy function, but another way to say it is we have this very nonlinear relationship, so it doesn't factor easily. So how do we deal with that? So in a CellX experiment, we have our data. We sequence the prior stuff. We know what the probability of each sequence is in the prior. We sequence either after one round or after multiple rounds. If we do 4 or 5 rounds of selection, we always sequence. You know, if we're going to sequence here at the 5th round, we're going to sequence here at the 4th round. So we know for any particular round of binding, the prior distribution and the posterior, because it's that ratio that matters, right? I showed you that already. It's the ratio of the posterior to the prior, which is related to the energy. But instead of it being a simple Boltzmann distribution, this is the distribution. So just to show you, so NS here, this is probably bad notation. N is not, in this case, the number. It's the ratio of the posterior to the prior. But we measure that for the experiment. So we have data. What we're trying to do is find a model that gives you the best fit to the data. And so the model contains the energy matrix. So now our weight matrix, our PWM, is the terms of it are specifically energy values. And we also have to solve for the protein concentration. And then there's a background effect. I told you there's always going to be some nonspecific binding. And this is just a scale factor to essentially fit it. Okay, so that's it. It's regression. We're trying to find the parameters. It's a small number of parameters. The weight matrix, if it's a 10-long binding site, you might think I have 40 parameters for it, but it's really only 3 per position because I'm always comparing. Remember I said, let's consider the reference sequence to be zero energy, and what I'm calculating is the delta, delta G, the change in energy for every possible mutation. There's really only 30 parameters for a 10-long binding site plus 3 others, so 33 parameters. It's not actually very much, given that we typically have, well, depends how many reads you get, but oftentimes we get millions of reads. So this is just an experiment. This is ZIF-268, which we did as our pilot experiment because it's the most well-studied protein in the whole universe. We essentially knew what the answer should be, and this is just showing that, in fact, we get the right answer. This is the fit to the data. And just as a comparison, oops, I didn't show it on here. We also ran, you know, a sort of standard motif modeler, which typically used that Boltzmann assumption. We used BioProspect. We tried several programs. BioProspector was the only one that didn't choke on the amount of data we gave it. This was, I think, 6 years ago, and nowadays there are quite a few programs that will take huge amounts of ChIP-seq data, for instance. But at the time, there weren't very many that would take that much data. Anyway, the point is that if you compare it to BioProspector, for instance, the fit we get is really, really quite a bit better. I didn't include the slide to show that. So for PBM data, here's what the actual arrays look like. I showed you how the experiment goes. You use a de Bruijn sequence to essentially chop it up such that every tenmer occurs somewhere on the array. This is what the data looks like. Now it's a fluorescence signal rather than counts, but you can use the same kind of model. I didn't mention it earlier, but my student who did the CellX data, the algorithm he wrote was called BEML, which stands for Binding Energy Estimates by Maximum Likelihood. So basically it's regression on those parameters. He then modified it specifically for PBM data. PBM data has characteristics that are different than CellX data, so he made a new version of it. And again, he got a good fit on this data set. you know, like any experiments, some proteins are more well behaved than others. Sometimes you get really nice fits like this, sometimes not. One of the things that we did, part of the motivation for him making a version of BMO, which we showed worked very well on Celex data, making a version that would work well on PBM data, was there was a paper that came out from the group that really invented PBMs where they did a very large collection of proteins. They did over 100 proteins in one paper, and the algorithms that they used didn't give very good fits. And in fact, they concluded that most proteins couldn't be represented well by a PWM. They had to be, so they concluded that there might actually be two modes of binding and you need two different PWMs. So we were skeptical, and so my student wrote this version, and what we found was that, in fact, most proteins could be well fit by a PWM. We could fit with a single PWM the data as well as they could, usually as they could with two different PWMs. So it really emphasizes the fact that the algorithm, it's not just collecting good data, you have to have good algorithms for analyzing it too. Then, after we did that one, the group, the original group, Tim Hughes, Martha Bullock, et cetera, they went back and they reanalyzed an extensive set of PBM data. They compared, I think, it's not written here, I think there were 25 or 26 different algorithms that people had predicted. And again, they concluded now that most transcription factors could be fit pretty well. About 90% of them could be fit pretty well by PWMs. Our method was among the best. There's another method from Harman Busemacher that's very similar. It uses the same sort of biophysical model, and so sometimes ours was better, sometimes his was better. But by and large, anything that uses this kind of biophysical model instead of a purely probabilistic model fit the data better. There were some proteins that did require multiple modes of interaction. Sometimes this dinucleotide thing mattered significantly, that you did significantly better if you included it. There were some that appear to recognize DNA in two different modes. Most of the time what that is it's a protein that binds as a dimer, and you can have variable spacing between the half sites. A PWM doesn't capture that, but as you all know now, you could have captured it with an HMM, which basically allows for gaps in the alignments. And so a simple extension of a PWM is a HMM. And so some proteins required that. Okay. This is just an example, one example. This is, we were studying at the time, a collection of proteins, zinc finger proteins. And so we set it up in such a way that one of the, this protein had three fingers, so its total binding site was 9 long. We fixed the binding site for one of the fingers, and that just meant that we didn't have to worry about, did the protein bind, you know, in different locations. We knew where it bound because we fixed part of the binding site. We randomized the other 6 positions, and then we went through this, and as I said, we scraped the plate. So here's the actual data. There are lots of sequences that just occur, you know, once or small number of times because they're on the plate. They didn't grow, but they're still there. But if I blow up the tail out here, there are other sequences that occur thousands of times. Those are obviously the high affinity ones because those colonies that have those binding sites are growing rapidly. Here's just the data. Again, you can see this sort of saturation effect. So it sort of fits the Fermi-Dirac, and then you have just nonspecific binding for lots of different sequences. We did this on lots and lots and lots. This is actually only about a third of the total of zinc finger proteins. And this is this, and actually similar or comparable experiments have been done by other groups now. There's tons of data out there about zinc fingers. We just pointed out that when you have this much data, you can actually train models that will predict the specificity of a zinc finger protein based on just the protein sequence. So you just give it the protein sequence, and it's not simply a lookup, because in fact we would give it sequences that don't exist in the database. We did this by a leave one out analysis, or actually a cross-validation analysis, where we train on a subset of the data and we try to predict the other subset, and we actually do pretty well. This is just some examples where the left columns here are the observed data. This is just for 6 different proteins, and this is what we predict. We essentially always get the consensus sequence right. The quantitation is not perfect, but it's not bad. And I should say this is the median accuracy. These numbers here represent the mean square error between the predicted and measured probabilities of binding. So the mean squared error is pretty small, and half of the time we do better than this, and half of the time we do worse. These are examples right around the median. And also just showing that we can do it for all different classes, whether they're GC rich or AT rich, it works pretty well for all of them. Okay, I'm gonna talk about a different experimental method. This is something we came up recently, although, I mean, it's a variation of things that have been around for a while. In fact, we started doing something similar to this 20 years ago, but then I sort of forgot about it, and I realized that we could take the same CellEx data that we've been doing before and actually get more information out of it, or at least better information. And we called, so first I have to remind you that the CellEx method. Remember, we sequenced the random pool after however many rounds, and then we sequence what's bound. And the ratio of, you know, the probability of a certain sequence I in the bound fraction divided by its prior probability is proportional to this equation here. This is the Fermi-Dirac equation, where the energy of that sequence and the protein concentration, they both matter. If we are going to, again, just compare how different sequences compare to some reference sequence. So we'll define a reference sequence, you know, a consensus to be energy zero. Now we're going to take the ratio of this to every other sequence I compared to that reference, and we get this equation. It's, I'm just showing you the proportionality as a constant, so we're just left with this terms right here. It's a little bit messy, but again, you can fit that, you can do regression, and you can try to find the best fit to your between your model and the data. But what I realized a little bit later is if instead of sequencing the prior, we actually sequence the unbound, the math gets much easier. It may not look at it immediately, but if I now compare the probability of that sequence in the bound versus the unbound fraction, and then I compare to a reference, the protein concentration has now dropped out. And in fact, if I take the log of that, I just have the energy directly. But let me describe that in maybe a more convenient way. Here's the reaction we're talking about, protein plus particular DNA sequence, it goes to equilibrium. What we call the definition of its affinity for that sequence, I would get by measuring the concentration of the bound complex, measuring the concentration of the free protein and the free DNA, and that ratio, that's the affinity, that's what I want. Well, as I said, what I really care about are relative affinities. I want to know how much the affinity changes as I start making mutations in the sequence. So the ratio of the affinity for sequence 1, 2, 3, up to however many I want to do, first of all, doesn't depend on the protein concentration now, right? That's a constant, so it drops out. In other words, all these different sequences are competing for the same pool of protein. And all I'm trying to look at is the distribution, which ones bind more than others. And so by simply taking those ratios, I get relative affinities. So in this picture, each line here represents a sequence, and the different colors are supposed to represent guys with different ranges of affinity. I run a gel, that's one way to separate it. You could also pull it out with an antibody or a filter binding or lots of different things. But there are advantages to gels that I'll get back to. I cut out the bound fraction, I cut out the unbound fraction, I send them off in sequencing. Just to show you an example, this is a paper that was published just a year ago now for the LAC repressor. This is the wild type LAC operator. And when it was first sequenced back in the middle 80s, it was a surprise to people that it was asymmetric. It's asymmetric partly because it's an odd number, so the middle base has to be asymmetric. But in addition, the GG on this side and an AA on that side, Jack Sadler actually deleted the G and changed those A's to two C's, so to make it symmetric and show that it actually bound a little bit better. So then the issue was, well, is the wild type one, it's not optimal for binding, is it optimal for something else, or is it simply good enough and evolution hasn't really pushed it to be the best possible? That argument raged for quite a while, and I think we now know the answer. But let me tell you what we did to address the question. So we made four random libraries, one in which we randomized those four asymmetric positions after deleting the middle base. And then we made libraries where we left the middle base in and we randomized it, plus we randomized either the right half or the left half. That is, in this case, I flipped the operator around, but I randomized the right half or the left half. And in this case, I actually added an extra base, so a four base spacer, and again, randomized the asymmetric positions. This is just showing you, isn't showing up very well, but the reproducibility between two different experiments. And not only are these two replicate experiments, they actually differ in an important way. They have different protein concentrations. Okay, so as I said, the protein concentration doesn't matter, but we knew no one would believe us unless we did the actual experiment, and in fact, the protein concentration doesn't matter. So what I'm showing on this one is the consensus sequence has the highest probability. I'm just showing the relative probability of every other sequence. Here I've converted that to energy. So now the consensus sequence is zero, and this is the predicted, well, it's the measured binding energy difference to every other sequence in the two replicates. The width here is about 0.1 kT. In other words, we have a very high precision for our measurements. Let me just show you the result that came out of this, because I think it ended up being interesting. So I showed all these libraries were mixed together. So we actually know the relative affinity of the best sequence in this library and this one. And as previously reported, this is the best overall sequence. So let me first of all describe this different kind of logo. I'm actually plotting energy values here directly, okay? So we've set it up such that the average at every position is zero, and I'm showing you minus energy, so the good guys are on top. Okay, so just like in a regular logo, you can read the consensus sequence across the top here. What this shows is that in the library with a two-base spacer, the best sequence is symmetric. If you look down at the bottom, when we add an extra base, and now I have a four-base spacer, again, the best operator is symmetric, but it's a different symmetry than that one. Prefers a different sequence. And in fact, now I've merged the two three-base libraries together. So first of all, that G is really important, and I'll show you why in a second. The one that has a two-base spacer wants to have two copies of this half. The one that has a four-base spacer wants to have two copies of this half. So what that says is that even though the LAC repressor is a homodimer, it binds as if it was a heterodimer. And in fact, that shows up in the structure. This is from Rob Kapteen's lab, where they determined the structure by NMR. People for a long time tried to do, they had determined the structure of the protein to the two-base operator because it's symmetric and you get nice crystals and everything like that. When they tried to do it for the true wild-type operator, I don't know what the reason was. They never got very good crystals, I think because it's asymmetric, and so it's hard to get, you know, any single cell might be in one or the other orientation, so you get sort of a blur. But he determined the structure using NMR, and you can see right here that the two different monomers bind to DNA somewhat differently. We call this side the compressed side. The reason that this G is so important, you have to have a CG in the middle because there's a hinge helix shown here that fits into the minor groove and actually inserts a leucine into the DNA there. And it really, really, really prefers a CG base pair to insert between. So in this case, you have a short or compressed side where that CG is very close to the helix turn helix region. And the other one, the protein essentially has to stretch out. It has to reach another, cross another base pair and rotate around by 30 degrees. And in so doing, it now prefers a different sequence. Anyway. I don't know if you're interested in LAC repressor or not, but this was one of the things that came out of this study. Even though the LAC repressor was the first protein, repressor protein ever identified and had been studied for a long time, nobody had ever done any kind of high throughput analysis of it. And so we actually got some results, many more of which are described in that paper that were surprising. The other thing, and the reason I really like gels more than other ways of separating bound and unbound, is if I have two proteins, X and Y, and those two proteins are of sufficiently different size, I can actually study cooperativity because I can get all four bands on a gel. So here's a case where I've got, these are really washed out, aren't they? Anyway, I've got DNA that has two potential binding sites. I had my two proteins, and I'm gonna get a mixture. Some of the DNA will be unbound, some of it will be bound by just protein Y or just protein X, and some of it will be bound by both proteins. But again, just by cutting these out, I can determine the specificity of a protein individually. So for instance, protein X, I just compare the DNA where that protein is bound alone to the unbound. I can also determine by comparing where they're both bound to that protein bound alone is, does the specificity of X change if Y is bound there already. And furthermore, I can measure the cooperativity. Well, I can measure the absolute cooperativity, but what I mostly care about, does the cooperativity change as a function of the sequence? And in this is a case where, a little bit like the Lac repressor, one of the things we've done is vary the spacing to identify how cooperativity varies as a function of spacing. We haven't published anything on this, although we we got to write a review article about something that we hadn't done yet, because it was so obvious that it would work. And in fact, it has worked, and we're going to publish it soon, but I'm not going to show you those results. So the summary of this part is that, you know, high-throughput methods can be great. You can generate lots and lots of data, and if you use good algorithms, you can get good specificity models. Most of the time, PWMs are pretty reasonable approximations. Not always. Sometimes you have to go to higher order models to capture it. Okay, so that's all kind of experimental stuff. Now I want to go to a different topic, which is discovering things purely by, motif discovery algorithms. So types of data we can have are sets of co-regulating genes. I have a set of genes that I know are all co-regulated in some way in the early days this was done by genetics. You knock out a factor and you see what genes change expression. Then it was done by microarrays, where I knock out a thing and I look at the genes that change expression. I can do co-binding regions, you know, ChIP-seq or something, where I pull down all the DNA that's bound by a particular protein. I can also do phylogenetic analysis, so-called phylogenetic footprinting. I look at, you know, across species, what is conserved, because that's the stuff that's conserved is what's important. And that's a way to get motifs. The goal is always to find the most significant pattern. In general, the problems are difficult enough. It's the same problem that I'm sure Bill talked about. The multiple alignment problem is what a computer scientist calls NP-complete. So you're always trying to use some heuristic that you hope will give you a good answer without looking at all possible answers. Okay. So here's an outline of the problem. Suppose I'm given a bunch of sequences, and these might be, you know, if it's a bacterial genome and I have a set of genes, I can probably narrow down the binding sites to within 100 base pairs or something, or nowadays in ChIP-seq experiments, I can often narrow it down to 200 or 300 base pairs. In the old days of microarrays, while I just saw a set of genes up or down regulated, I didn't really know where to look. And, you know, I might have to, typically people would look over 2 or 3 kb, hoping that that's where the important things were. The point is that what I'm assuming is that there's some pattern in here, the actual binding site, and I'm trying to find that pattern. So this is just an example from E. coli. This is a set of 18 upstream regions, the upstream regions for 18 E. coli genes, all of which were known to be regulated by CRP. And the question we set out to answer was, can I take this data as input and end up with both a model for what the CRP binding site looks like and where the binding site is on each sequence? Okay? If you gave me either one, if you told me what the motif was, I could just scan along like I showed you earlier and tell you where the binding site was. Or if you told me where the binding sites was, I would just line them up and I would get the motif. But I'm asking you to get both simultaneously. This just shows that we developed an algorithm that worked a long time ago. It was a very simple greedy algorithm. We could pull out the binding sites, we could generate the motif, etc. But what I'm going to talk about are two somewhat newer algorithms. They each came out a couple years after ours, and they're more sophisticated. They're sort of classy statistical algorithms, so that's what I'm going to talk about. So one is based on expectation maximization, and I'm just going to give you in words a description of how it works. I'm not going to write out all the equations. Many of the equations we've already covered when we talked about likelihood ratios. So here's the basic idea. Well, I just told you this. If you were given the sites, you could estimate the PWM from it. Or if you were given the PWM, you could pick out the most likely sites. But what we need to do is do both simultaneously. So what we're going to do is we're going to make an initial guess. The way the original PWM works, by the way, the way the original EM algorithm works, this is the basis of the MEME program, which probably many of you have heard of or seen. It has a very nice website. I think that's what the workshop is going to be about, or the exercise you're going to do. So MEME is a program that implements this algorithm. So you make an initial PWM just by averaging over all possible sites. Now, if I have lots of data, that's going to be basically just washed out. It's going to look like almost nothing. But if it even has a little bit of a hint that puts me in the right direction, if the sites I'm looking for are slightly overrepresented compared to what I expect by chance, it'll sort of point me in the right direction. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that initial PWM, I'm going to scan all of the sequences, and that's going to tell me the probability that the protein is bound. If I go back to this figure, given any PWM, I can scan along the sequence and I can say, well, the probability that it's bound here is 0.01, the probability that it's bound there is 0.02, maybe the probability that it's bound there is actually 0.6, you know, but I can calculate those probabilities given a PWM, and so I'll do that, and now I have a new weighting of all the sites, so I'll generate a new PWM based on that, and then I'll do it again. This approach is guaranteed to converge, and it's guaranteed to increase the likelihood at every step. So that's good, if it converges to the right answer. There's no guarantee it's going to converge to the right answer. It depends on where it started. It's what's called a local hill climbing. So you give it an initial guess. So in fact, the way MEAN usually works is it actually starts off making a few different initial guesses and then picks the one that converges to the best. But again, there's no absolute guarantee that it'll always work. But in general, these methods work pretty well. Let me tell you a variation of this, which is called the Gibbs sampling algorithm. The basic idea is the same, but there's, I guess, two important differences. So again, given the sites, if you gave me the sites, I could estimate the PWM, or if you gave me the PWM, I could estimate the probability of binding. I'm going to iterate them too, but now I'm going to do it somewhat differently. Instead of starting with my initial data, and just averaging over everything together and making a single PWM, which is the average of all the sites, weighted by their probability. For each sequence, I'm just going to pick a site, one site, and say, I think this is it. Obviously, when I start off doing this, it's just going to be a random guess, okay? The other thing is, if I have n sequences, I'm going to leave one out. So I'm going to base my initial guesses on n minus one sequences. So I have n minus one sites. I'm going to take that initial guess and make a PWM out of it just by the log odds method I described. One thing is I'm going to add pseudo counts. I don't know if you've had this before, but I don't want any probabilities to go to zero. Because remember, I want to take this new matrix and now I'm going to use that to estimate where the binding site is. And if anytime something goes to zero, it means I've vetoed it. It can never happen again. So I don't want that to happen. So I'm going to add. And exactly how much you add is one of the parameters, but you add essentially a pseudo count. Then you use this current PWM, and you take the sequence that was left out, and you try to estimate where the binding site is on that. I'm just going to pick one site, but I'm not going to just pick the best one. This is where the Gibbs sampling idea comes from. I'm going to sample from all of the potential binding sites based on their probabilities. You know, if my motif is right, then that probability should be the probability that it's bound in different places. Well, I don't expect it to be right early on, but I'm still going to sample from that distribution. So this lends an air of stochasticity to it. If I take the same data and run it multiple times, I'm not necessarily going to get the same answer. So that's an advantage over the EM, because remember I said it always converges, given any particular starting point, but may be not to the right place. So it can get caught in what's called a local optimum. It gets stuck in the optimum that you got to from wherever you started. This one could get stuck in a local optimum, but there's a good chance it will jump out of it because it's stochastic. Okay. That's the main advantage. You still iterate to convergence, although in convergence here doesn't necessarily converge, but what tends is it happens to plateau. And typically you run it multiple times just because of this fact that you never know for sure it's not caught in some local optimum. I can show you an example from the first paper. This was actually originally applied to protein sequences, protein domains, but in fact it's been used much more frequently with DNA binding sites. So here's a case. So notice up here, this is the function they're trying to maximize, this F. This looks a lot like information content, right? This is the counts of, you know, each base at each position. Here J was from 1 to 20, because I said they were doing it on proteins, but in fact our alphabet is only going to be 1 to 4. This ratio looks like the probability of the observed data divided by some background. But notice over here, this is where the pseudo counts come in. So this probability here is not just the data itself, that is the counts that you observe in whatever you think are the binding sites at this moment, but you add a little bit of pseudo counts. So it's not quite information content, it's information content that's adjusted slightly with pseudo counts. Okay, but that's what we're trying to maximize. We're trying to find the set of sites that have the best, highest information content, because as I showed you earlier, that means it's the maximum likelihood estimate for the motif. This just shows three runs on the same data. And as I said, so in run one, it went to the right answer or very, very quickly. But remember, it doesn't converge. It doesn't go up every step. So it got to something that's very right, close to the right answer, and then it kind of jiggled around a little bit, but it more or less stayed there. In run two, it got caught in some kind of local plateau for a while and then jumped up, and it actually never quite reached the top. And I'll tell you why in a second. The third one, it got caught in some local optimum for quite a while, but eventually made it up to the best site. It turned out that these all converged to the same model with one exception. One in three, the motif lined up perfectly with the sites. In run two, it was actually offset by one. So it's missing one important position, and it has one position at the other end that's kind of random. But you can see that when you take the sites and line them up. You say, oh, I should have just moved it over one, and then they would have all converged to the same answer. So anyway, Gibbs sampler is a nice algorithm. It generally works. I mentioned phylogenetic footprinting. So this is what I just described in a single species. I have a bunch of promoters or regions of the genome that I think are bound by the same factor. I'm going to do some kind of motif finding. In eukaryotic species, as I said, one of the hardest things to know, at least in the days before people did, you know, ChIP-seq or something, is all you had is a set of genes that were co-regulated is where do you look? Because we know, you know, there's things happening at the promoter, but there are also enhancers that are far away and so on. And so this is just showing that I can take multiple species and I can first of all filter it in these boxes here for what's conserved. I know the things that are important are likely to be conserved, so that lets me sort of narrow down the search space. Here's an example. This is an example from yeast, which is relatively simple. But if you just took four species and three genes that were all known to be regulated by LU3, in this case, you could do essentially a promoter comparison. We did an alignment over, I think we started with 600 base pairs because yeast promoters are relatively compact. So we started with a relatively small search space. What we found was that there are these highly conserved regions. A star here means it's conserved in at least three out of the four species. But in fact, these are too long. It doesn't actually tell you what the binding site is, but we think it's probably embedded in that, and I've boxed them there. But in fact, if you take those things, you actually end up with the LU3 motif that just pops out quite nicely. So this is a case of leveraging the fact that we think the motifs that we're interested in not only are going to occur in all the genes that are regulated, but they're also probably conserved phylogenetically across species. My student, Ting Wang, then went one step further, and he showed you could actually do this whole genome-wide. You take all gene I, whatever it is, from all the different species, and you first do phylogenetic footprinting. What is conserved across those genes? And you turn that into a profile or a PWM, essentially. Then you're gonna do that for all the genes. Then you could compare every gene to every other gene. But now instead of comparing sequences to sequences, you're comparing profiles to profiles. But what happens is you actually, your database of profiles, your query profile, you find these high-scoring pairs, sort of like in BLAST, and you can go back and line them up. And what you end up with in the end is not only the motif, the part that's conserved not only across species, but also between genes. So you get that motif, you get the genes that are in that cluster, and you get, that's basically what you get out of it. And this worked quite well. So this paper was done on yeast, which is, again, a pretty simple organism. Since then, we've done it on C. elegans, and we get lots of motifs, some of which are known to be true, but not all of them have been tested. So we don't really know what the false positive rate is. I think that's my last slide. So I'll stop and take questions. Yes. Yeah, in this one, we don't know what the transcription factor is. I mean, that's a really good question. Even in the case that I mentioned before, any of these cases where we're doing motif finding, we don't necessarily know what the factor is. If you start with genes that are co-regulated, you don't know what the factor is. In fact, one of the things that people used this approach for was they would try to find the motif that explains the co-regulation, and then if they're lucky, that motif actually points them to what the factor is. But we don't always know. On the other hand, another kind of data would be ChIP-seq data, for instance. So now you know what the factor is because that's what you started with. So tomorrow I'll talk about coming at things from different directions. You can have genetic information about genes that are co-regulated or co-expressed, or you can have biochemical information about what regions of the genome are bound by a specific factor. But in both cases, you can be misled. So integrating them together helps a lot. So for instance, if I delete a gene, which is easy to do in yeast, for instance, and I see which other genes, if I delete a transcription factor and ask which genes have their expression changed, it's going to be ones that are directly regulated, but also maybe ones that are indirectly regulated, right? Because this transcription factor may control other transcription factors and everything downstream from that point. So I could end up with false positives. The same thing with what's called localization analysis, where I take a factor and I do a ChIP-seq. I say where it's bound in the genome. Well, I know that it's bound there, but that doesn't mean it's actually functional. In fact, there's evidence that a lot of those things are non-functional. So one of the things we care about trying to get at is what are the functional relationships, which factors bind to what sites and control what genes. I mean, you've hit an important point, and people deal with it in different ways. In the early days, I would say that what people did was if they did a ChIP-seq, or actually in the early days, it was mostly done on ChIP-chip, on arrays. If they came across a region that was bound by their protein and it contained repetitive DNA, they just threw that out. They didn't want to have to deal with it. They knew it was probably confounding, and they assumed that it was that the factor they were interested in wasn't actually binding to repetitive DNA. Well, this same student of mine, Ting Wang, in his postdoc, he decided not to throw it out. And what he found was that, in fact, certain transcription factors are enriched in certain kinds of repetitive DNA. And there is now one of the projects he works on is figuring out how these repetitive sequences evolve to have binding sites, and that lets them jump around the genome. And so you end up with whole new regulatory networks that are based on things like that. So in the early days, people ignored it because they didn't know what to do with it. Now they're taking it into account, but how you deal with it, how you treat it such that it's not a false positive that just shows up is tricky. It's not necessarily easy. That's right. That's right. That's right. So all this DNA, repetitive DNA, as well as other DNA, I don't know, in the last few years, there's this whole issue of, is it junk DNA or is it important? I like the quote from Sidney Brenner many years ago. Somebody was asking him something about junk DNA. He says, well, remember, this is junk. This is what you keep in your attic. It's not the garbage that you put out at the curb and gets hauled away. It's stuck in the attic because who knows, maybe you'll use it someday or something. Maybe it has some value. So that was his definition of junk is, we don't know what it's for, but maybe it has some value. And as we're finding out, a lot of what we used to think is junk is actually relevant in one way or other. I mean, there probably is still real junk, but a lot of it has some function. Yeah?
Can you predict the effects of mutations in transcription factors on the position and wavelength of the
Well, we can do it for zinc fingers now. I mean, that was the goal of that one thing, was to actually predict the motif, the PWM, from the protein sequence, either from single mutations of an existing protein or even from just something from scratch. And we've done the same thing for homeodomains, but for most proteins, it's not really very feasible yet. And even with the zinc fingers, I mean, we're far from perfect. And there are other people. I mean, Mona Singh at Princeton has a nice website that predicts motifs for zinc finger proteins, and there are a couple other groups. I mean, zinc finger proteins have now been studied so well that I think for almost any zinc finger protein, you could predict its motif from its sequence. However, there's another complication with zinc finger proteins. You're going to talk about zinc finger proteins tomorrow? No, you're not. Okay. There's another complication with zinc finger proteins is in that many of them have lots of fingers. CTCF has 11, is that right? And there are some with more than that. And I think it's pretty clear that they don't all use the same fingers when they bind DNA. So then that means they're going to have different motifs just because it might use some subset of fingers to bind one piece of DNA and a different subset of fingers to bind a different piece of DNA. So if it's a lot of these canonical zinc finger proteins, all the ones in yeast and many of them in human have usually three or sometimes four fingers, and those you can predict pretty well. But as soon as you get more than that, it's challenging.
The question I had is it possible that in vivo the interaction between the protein and the DNA is out of sort of an equilibrium, so the predictions you get are different from what you've
seen? Yeah, I mean, certainly anything happening in a cell is not really at equilibrium. Who was it? I was once at a talk, and somebody said, you know, Napoleon's at equilibrium, the rest of us aren't. And so, you know, inside a cell, things are not really equilibrium. The question is, how good an approximation is that? And we don't know exactly. For some things, it's clear you have to take kinetics into account. But for these kinds of models, it seems like equilibrium approximations are probably reasonable most of the time. But I think that's an open question, really. Well, transcription, that's a kinetic process. It's not at equilibrium. But in terms of the binding events, if you're just talking about just strict binding, I think it's an open question, but for the most part, people assume equilibrium. We assume that the equilibrium parameters tell us, you know, what are the good binding sites and the bad binding sites. And we think that approximation works pretty well. But, you know, we're far from having complete cellular models, and that may be one of the reasons is we're treating things at equilibrium when they're really not.
So the position weight matrices you calculate in vitro when you try to apply them to the binding sites, in vivo they're close to what you need.
Yeah, usually they work pretty well. So a number of these things where people have determined the motif for some in vitro experiment, then they ask, well, how well does it match to a ChIP-seq experiment? Almost all the time, they fit quite well. The times when they don't, or when the in vivo ChIP stuff, sometimes you'll find an additional motif because you're looking at a factor that actually binds cooperatively with something else, and that can be really useful information. But I would say the vast majority of the time, you can explain the ChIP-seq peaks for a given factor if you know the PWM for that factor. That is, you can explain, you know, where you can find where the binding site is and explains that. That what's going on. Of course, the other thing you have to do, if you wanted to predict what the ChIP-seq data would look like for a given factor, you have to know, well, what regions of the genome are accessible, right? Because those things go together. If I just take a PWM and I scan it across the genome, I'm going to get thousands or tens of thousands of hits that are very good matches to the PWM. Most of those won't show up in the ChIP-seq data because they're wrapped up in chromatin. They're not available. So by itself, it's not a good predictor. As I said, if you have ChIP-seq data, you can usually explain the data well with the PWM.
But you might see binding where the PWM tells you it's very unlikely.
That can happen, and that's usually referred to as indirect binding. That can be a case where the PWM, the transcription factor that you use to pull out, is not binding directly to the DNA, or maybe it's binding to a very weak site, but through cooperativity with something else. So it does happen, and the question is whether those are noise or whether they're real, and if they are real, do they indicate some kind of indirect thing. And if you see that, then that's actually interesting because it says, well, what's the other factor? And let's go looking for another motif that shows up in the peaks where the factor, I know what its motif is, I don't see copies of that motif, so there must be some other factor that it's binding to that brings it there. What is that factor? Because the cooperativity, yeah. I didn't go into it. I mean, I showed you that thing that we're studying cooperativity using this spec-seq method. We started off doing SOX 2 and OCT 4 because they're very well characterized, and so we sort of again knew what the answer we expected, and we're seeing if our method is working. And those are cases where there's very strong cooperativity if they're bound immediately adjacent. One of the things that we were able to show is as soon as we add some spacing between them, the cooperativity essentially goes away. Now they bind as if they're binding independently. We can test, you know, different orders and things like that, all in essentially one lane of one gel, and get quite a bit of information about what's important for cooperativity. Okay, no more questions. I'm around the rest of today. I'm around tomorrow. I'm around Sunday morning. So if you have questions along the way, just let me know.